Now, we see in our last video how the Mongols had taken over Asia. They expanded into China, took the Jin, the Song Dynasty. They went into the independent Russian states, controlled that all the way to Eastern Europe. And then they went into the Muslim states and eventually were, that was the extent of their expansion. We've seen the Mamluks, slave dynasty, come to power in Egypt. And we've seen how this dynasty had taken over Jerusalem, and they had a decisive battle of Anjalut and stopped the Mongol advance. And now they're contending with the Byzantine Empire. And then we have Eastern or the Western European countries changing power, and all because of the Kingdom of Sicily, where this will start. We've already discussed how the Holy Roman Emperor Frederick II gained the kingdom of the two Sicilies. But the popes were insistent that the German emperor ruled in Sicily, and he called on any French lord that would help them get rid of the German Hohenstaufen king. Now, Charles of Anjou, the brother of the present-day king in France, and who just got back from the last crusade, answered the call, for pure political motives, of course. Well, he came down to Italy, and in 1268, he met Manfred, the last of Frederick II's heirs to the throne, and he defeated him in battle. Now, much to the Pope's dismay, Charles kept the crown of Sicily for himself. So the new Holy Roman Emperor, Conrad IV, he marched an army down there to take on Charles of Anjou and try to get Sicily back and restore his power. Charles defeated the German Emperor Conrad in battle, and Conrad lost his life, and the Hohenstaufen dynasty came to an end. For the next 140 years, various dynasties would rule in Germany, but Germany lost much of its prestige. Now Charles, who kicked out the Germans, he taxed the Sicilians so heavily that they offered their crown to the King of Aragon, and this would be called the Sicilian Vespars. Now, they wanted to get rid of Charles. But in Spain, after they kicked out the Muslims, there was still a little Muslim enclave that they had to deal with down here at the bottom. You see the green. And Spain was controlled by two different territories, the Crown of Aragon, Castile, Portugal, and up in the northern area. However, the King of Aragon did not want to miss this opportunity. And together with the Sicilian fleet and a Spanish fleet, they fought Charles's fleet off the coast of Sicily. And they defeated the French fleet. And Charles ended up fleeing. Now, what he did was he appealed to the Pope, and them two together went to the French king, Philip III, and asked him to embark on a crusade against Aragon, which was a terrible, terrible failure. And Philip ended up dying on this quest. Now, Philip IV, who started his own quest to alter the power of the popes, and also the papacy was, you know, you can say squandering its prestige because they were calling all these foolish crusades and they were losing their, how do you say it, godlike image in the sight of the people. Now, and this is where the papacy started to decline, you know, into everybody's puppet. Now, England and the Spanish would both be continuing a power struggle with the French. But the English had their own problems. They were fighting with the Scots and the Irish. And in 1264 to 1267, there was another Barren War, which Henry III squashed. And it was over the administration and legislations and the institutions. But during his reign, he did establish the High English Court, which was the highest court of the land in the future. But the lastly and most famously branch that he was starting to organize was Parliament. Now, before and after 1300, and mainly owing to his son, Edward I, the Parliament grew stronger and became a permanent fixture in the English government. Now, besides his governmental advancements, he was a warrior, and he almost succeeded in uniting the entire Isle of Britain. He conquered the Welsh, and then he almost conquered the Scots and subdued them. But soon after his death, his son, Edward II, known as Edward the Gay, he had lost Scotland. And he had a couple big battles with the Scots.
He relied still on the heavy horse to win him the day. And the English would soon learn that the heavy horse was too expensive to field. And they found a new weapon, the Welsh longbow, which was cheaper and far more effective against cavalry. And that's what made England a good army. They adapted to new tactics.
Crude elm longbows to great effect, being able, as contemporary commentators observed, to pierce armor and pin a knight to his saddle. To be as effective as a mounted knight was one with implications that made it easy to ignore. Edward II chose to put all his faith in cavalry at the Battle of Bannockburn in 1314. Archers were driven into disarray by Scots horsemen attacking their exposed flank, whilst his cavalry was butchered on Scottish flanks. To retrieve the reputation of English arms in Scotland and to set in motion, through two stunning victories, the chain of events that would lead to triumph on the field of Agincourt. Edward III developed his own method of battle. Fighting the Scots at Halidon Hill in 1333, King Edward divided his army into three units, or battles, of dismounted men-at-arms, each with two wings of archers drawn up to form a protruding wedge. This wedge was able to fire first into an attacking enemy's front ranks, and then, as it closed for the melee, into its flanks. When they attacked, the Scots were shot to pieces.
The longbow was undoubtedly the most devastating weapon developed in the whole of the Middle Ages, until perhaps the coming of the more important forms of firearm. It was a 6-foot weapon, of course. It needed up to a 150-pound pull to bring the cloth yard shaft all the way back to the ear. And it was provided, as we know, a whole range of different kinds of arrowheads for different purposes. The most usual one was, of course, the narrow steel point, which is used for the armor-piercing role, as you might say. But it was also a very broad flanged arrow, which was used basically against cavalry horses, which were naturally the most vulnerable part of a knight charging on horseback. As for range, well, something like 400 yards was probably the maximum, but 200 yards was very effective battle range, and down at 60 yards it was absolutely lethal. A good archer could get off something like 10 shots in a minute, so at any one time there might well be 3 arrows in the air from his particular bow. Multiply that by 5,000 archers and you've got something like 15,000 cloth yard shafts falling like a pattering hail upon the enemy's cavalry. It was a daunting weapon indeed. It took a long time to make a proper archer, of course. As little boys, they had to learn to hold out their left arms and shoulders, always carrying a heavier and heavier weight, so they got that absolutely straight alignment of shoulder and arm to get that really solid, because that was the secret of a bowman. He had to have that right. As a result, they became very expensive eventually. 6/3 farthings was at one time the pay of an archer, which at this time was a very considerable amount of money. In the end, perhaps they overpriced themselves out of the market, and that is when the firearm really came to take over. But until that time, there was no weapon like it for killing power in any of the armies of Europe.
While King Edward's eyes were on the successful conclusion of his campaign in Scotland, events in France were proving the fragile nature of the relationship between the two monarchies. In 1337, convinced that the English were plotting with his enemies to overthrow him, King Philip VI of France formally confiscated Aquitaine from Edward III. Edward responded by renewing his claim to the French throne and withdrawing his allegiance. War was now inevitable.
England was unified around the crown in the High Middle Ages and would remain a basically well-governed and unified country right up to modern times. France's prestige came close to being squandered by Louis's more ruthless grandson, Philip IV, known as the Fair, from 1285 to 1314. Philip fought many battles at once, seeking to round out French territories in the northeast and southwest and to gain full control over the French church instead of sharing it with the Pope in Rome. All these activities forced him to accelerate the process of governmental centralization, especially with the aim of trying to raise money. Thus, his reign saw the quick formulation of many administrative institutions that came close to completing the development of medieval French government, as the contemporary reign of Edward I did in England. Philip the Fair was successful in reducing the Pope to the level of a virtual French figurehead. By the end of his reign, France was unquestionably the strongest power in Europe. With only a 16th century interruption, it would remain so until the 19th century. Now, starting in the 1300s, we have three major crises that take place. And first, it is the Hundred Years' War between
the French and the English. Second, it's the crisis of the papacy. And then third is the Black Death. We will take a look at the Hundred Years' War first, in its first phase. Now, the causes were complex and tedious. Suffice it to say, upon the death of the French King Charles VI in 1328, the royal line of the Capetian kings ended. Now, the fact that this line of succession to the French throne died out in 1328, to be replaced thereafter by the related Valois dynasty, meant that the English kings, who themselves descended from the Capetians as a result of intermarriage, laid claim to the French crown itself. But the French had in standing a law of their own that said no female descendants can sit on the French crown. Another cause of strife was that the English economic interest in the wool trade with Flanders led them to support the frequent attempts of the Flemish burghers to rebel against the French rule. Yet another problem was a long-standing problem, which the French territory was being held by the English. You can see here in this map, the English still held that top of the north of France a little bit and this bottom part. And so at the beginning of the 14th century, the English king still ruled much of the rich southern French lands of Gascony and Aquitaine as vassals of the French crown. And so in 1337, the English basically started the war, and they sent a fleet over to invade a tiny island of Getsan. And then they proceeded to march inland. Now, France should have had no difficulty in defeating the English at the start of the war, because France was the richest country in Europe. It outnumbered England in population by like 15 million in France to fewer than 4 million in the English. It also was war-hardened with the reputation of countless victories. The English had no such reputation of the sort, and the French had a experienced and large nobility. But what happened here is the English, they learned new tactics, and that was the English longbow. So no matter how experienced, how hardened, and how massive the French heavy cavalry was, the English longbow could penetrate the armor and unhorse the knight. Now, another reason for English success was that the war was always fought on French soil. So that being the case, English soldiers were eager to fight because they could look forward to the rich plunder, while their own homeland suffered none of the disasters of war. And then worst of all, the French were in fact badly divided. The French crown had always had, you know, to fear provincial attempts of them asserting their own autonomy, especially during periods of warfare, when there were several highly inept kings and the English encouraged internal French dissensions. Many aristocratic provincial leaders took advantage of the confusion to ally with the enemy and seek their own advantage. Now, the war started out with skirmishes, with the English winning most of these as they're marching inland. They're just pushing aside provincial armies and militia until the first decisive battle came at Crecy.
His army landed in France. The style of warfare of the English army was to become sadly familiar to many Frenchmen. The English cut a destructive sway through Normandy, robbing, pillaging, and plundering as they went. Amassed an army of around 40,000 men, eager to be avenged on the invaders by crushing them in battle. As soon as they were mustered, they set off in pursuit. After a brief chase, King Edward drew up his forces on a ridge near the little town of Crecy. They numbered about 12,000, half of them archers. Arranged into three battles, with dismounted men-at-arms flanked by archers, the English were in a good defensive position. On the 26th of August, a massive French army arrived before the silent English lines. Instead of waiting to be formed into commanded battles, the impetuous French nobility wished to attack immediately. It was now that the lack of a clear command structure within the cosmopolitan French army became apparent. It was this factor which led to confusion and frustration. The French sent forward a contingent of Genoese crossbowmen to harry the English ranks. In the duel of archery that followed, the superior rate of fire of the longbow forced the Genoese to retire. Jean Froissart was told of what followed by an eyewitness. With their ranks thinning considerably, the French rode forward to assault the English men-at-arms, only to find the arrow storms now pouring into their flanks. Bloody chaos took place. The ridge in front of the English became a seething mass of dead and wounded horses and men. The French ranks were compressed, so men had no room to fight. The arrows kept coming, and all semblance of order vanished. Those Frenchmen, still willing to fight, reformed and attacked. But it was too late. When the sun rose the next day, 10,000 French lay dead on the field. The victory of Crecy demonstrated the destructive power of the longbow, even against the latest mail and plate armor. French chivalry was decimated, French government paralyzed by despondency. Yet within 20 years, it would happen again. In 1356, there was another English chevauchée, or armed raid, this time into Poitou. It was led by King Edward's eldest son, the Black Prince. Once again, the English found themselves trapped by a French army of over 30,000 men. The English force totaled 8,000, which included 4,000 archers. They took up positions along a wooded ridge near Poitiers. The first French attack was a suicidal frontal assault by 300 hand-picked knights, which was easily shot to pieces. The next assault was made by 2,000 men-at-arms on foot, who had struggled for 2 miles to reach the English lines. But the archers, moving swiftly, continued to pour arrows into the French flanks and rear. And when they ran out of arrows, they fell on with sword, axe, and mallet. The French broke and fled back into the next division, which had been slow in moving to reinforce its comrades. This division broke too and fled. The people of France were stunned. Once again, they had suffered a catastrophic defeat against an English army they had greatly outnumbered. Over the next 20 years, with many of its leaders dead or awaiting ransom in England in the aftermath of Poitiers, France was ravaged by further military expeditions, peasants' revolts, and roving contingents of unemployed soldiers, the so-called free companies. These men picked the land clean until a war in Castile drew them away with the prospect of pay and booty. The battered, war-torn French could not know it, but their fortunes were to change for the better. By the 1370s, under the rule of King Charles the Wise, France was regaining its territory, and a generation of English war leaders, worn out by constant campaigning, were dying out. The Black Prince died in 1376, his father the year after. As the years went by, Crecy and Poitiers became memories of past glories. The territory won in battle had been lost, and Englishmen looked for a new leader, cast in the mold of the Black Prince.
By 1377, England was left with the Red Territories here in France. The only territory they now held in the north was the little red port of Calais, which gave them a spot to invade from. Now, the Babylonian captivity period came to an end in 1378. During the Babylonian captivity, the papacy was located in Avignon instead of Rome and was generally subservient to the interests of the French crown. There were several reasons for this. The most obvious was that since the test of strength between Philip the Fair and Boniface VIII had resulted in a clear victory for the French king, Subsequent popes were unwilling to risk French royal ear. In fact, once the popes recognized that they could not give orders to the French kings, they found that they could gain certain advantages from currying their favor. And one was a safe home in southern France, away from all the turmoil in Italy, against the German princes.
Then, in 1338, a drought or an earthquake violently disturbed the balance of nature. Driven from its natural habitat, the bacillus began a deadly exodus. From its cradle in Central Asia, the plague slowly migrated towards man. It was carried in the bloodstream of black rats and in the fleas which fed on them. The bacillus spread quickly as it moved along trade routes in the blood of infected rats. With it came the plague, spreading like a deadly river of death, first into China and then south into India and west into Egypt and Asia Minor. Within 8 years, it had reached the Crimea. Rumors of a terrible plague raging in the east began to circulate through the Mediterranean seaports, but no one thought this disease would strike Europe. A group of Italian merchants, expelled from their trading post of Tana, had taken refuge in the fortified city of Kaffa on the Black Sea. Tensions between the Christian merchants from Italy and the local Muslim residents erupted in a street brawl. A minor skirmish soon became a war. The Muslims sought help from their local Mongol prince to lay siege to the Italians inside the walls of Kaffa. The siege was almost a year old when the plague erupted amongst the Mongol army. So many soldiers died that they were forced to call off the siege. But before they withdrew, the prince came up with a deadly plan, one of the first and most highly effective forms of germ warfare. Giant wooden siege machines were already lined up outside the city walls. Now the Mongol prince ordered his troops to load the catapults with a deadly new missile. One by one, the rotting carcasses of plague-infected soldiers were hurled through the air over Kaffa's walls. Seemed like mountains of dead were thrown into the city. Soon the rotting corpses tainted the air and poisoned the water supply. Within days, the people inside the walls of Kaffa began to die. Those merchants who could escape hurried aboard their galleys and prepared to set sail for Italy. Flea-infested rats climbed the mooring ropes and hid in the holds of the ships that were heading for the Mediterranean. Little did the sailors know what a deadly cargo they were carrying. No one noticed that the shipboard rats were diseased. The galleys sailed from port to port on their long journey back to Italy. But no one would let them dock when it was seen that the sailors were dying. In October 1347, the merchants finally reached the port of Messina in Sicily. The terrified harbour masters tried to isolate the ships, but it was already too late. Even as the first mooring ropes were being tied, the rats were making their way ashore. Although the galleys were forced to move on, this brief encounter was long enough for the Black Death to enter Europe. Europe in 1348 was already overpopulated and beset with problems. Weakened by wars, harvest failures, famines, and other epidemics, the plague was yet another in a series of disasters to strike Europe. After a week, the plague had spread throughout the city of Messina. Carts loaded with corpses arrived at the churches almost by the hour.
Men were borne to burial by day and night, with only a short service. The houses of the dead were shut up, for no one dared enter them.
Those living in already overcrowded houses were oblivious to the arrival of the infected black rats. Fleas thrived in the filth and clung to the clothes of the dead, which were then sold or passed on.
When anyone who is infected by the disease dies, all who visit him or do business with him, or even carry him to the grave, quickly follow him there.
As the plague spread into the surrounding countryside, it was clear that no one was safe. Within a month, the Black Death had spread throughout Sicily. Friar Michael set off on a journey round the island. Believing the plague was decreed by God and that man should not oppose it, he hoped to bring spiritual comfort to the sick. Many priests had already died, but Michael was one of the few who would survive the plague and live to describe its horrors.
On the day the victim was stricken, blisters and boils appeared on the arms, legs, and neck. They so weakened and tormented his body that he had to take to his bed. Soon the boils grew to the size of a walnut, then to that of a hen's egg or a goose's egg, and they were exceedingly painful. The sickness lasted 3 days. By the fourth day, the plague had claimed another victim.
People reacted to the plague with astonishment, bewilderment, and terror. They thought they were witnessing the end of the world, God's punishment for all the sin on earth.
Kind God, I beg that your anger may cease, that you do not destroy sinners in this way, and that you do not allow the just to be condemned with the unjust.
Most people believed that the plague was literally hell on earth, the last triumph of evil before the coming of Christ in judgment. With hundreds dying every day, Michael was one of the few priests still devoted.
What more is there to say? Corpses lay unattended in their own homes. No priests, sons, fathers, or kinsmen dared to enter.
Few who caught the disease ever recovered. So rapidly did it spread that it seemed one man could infect the whole world. ships, with their lethal cargoes of infected rats and fleas, were the surest and fastest means of spreading the plague. Within days of a ship putting into port, the entire town would have been exposed to the deadly bacillus. From Sicily, the plague reached the mainland and swept across Italy. Following the trade routes, it spread in all directions, covering the land with a blanket of death. Travelers told stories of deserted villages and miles of countryside littered with bodies. In early 1348, Guy de Chilliac, a cleric and the Pope's personal doctor, heard news that the Black Death was only weeks from the papal palace at Avignon. Guy studied the movement of the stars and planets and reported his findings to his master, Pope Clement VI. He explained that God's warnings, heavy clouds, blasts of hot winds, falling stars, and a column of fire seen above the papal palace, all signaled that a terrible affliction was at hand.
The configuration of the heavens is the cause of this pestilence. In 1345, at 1 hour after noon on March the 20th, there was a major conjunction of three planets in Aquarius. This signifies death.
At once, de Chilliac scoured the books of Arab philosophers and physicians and the reports of the medical faculty in Paris for advice on how to avert the impending disaster. The philosophers advised that the corrupted air should be purified with fire. This would drive away the infected cloud that caused the plague. So when the plague was in reach of the Pope's palace, de Chilliac ordered huge fires to be built within the papal grounds. Then the doctor arranged for the Pope to sit between them. The Pope's fires burned day and night for 4 months, while the plague raged through Avignon. No rat or flea could penetrate the intense heat. The Pope sat, protected, in splendid isolation, all through the heat of the summer. Meanwhile, in the city of Avignon, thousands continued to die. Whenever he could summon the strength, he would record his symptoms in detail. To his surprise, he began to record a recovery. Having survived the plague, de Chilliac was even more determined to continue his research. It was not long before he made a breakthrough.
It was of two types. The first with continuous fever and spitting of blood. From this, one died in 3 days. The second, also with continuous fever, but with carbuncles on the armpits and groin. From this, one died in 5 days.
De Chilliac had correctly diagnosed that there were two types of plague, and that the first, pneumonic plague, was more infectious and more deadly than the second, bubonic plague. So remarkable was this discovery that the Pope, for the first time, gave his blessing to the dissection of the dead, which had previously been forbidden as a sin. Most people had no confidence in doctors. The rich simply fled from the plague, but most could not. Sometimes the sick were even bricked up in their houses to stop the disease from spreading, but to no avail. Some tried to find their own cures. They took pills made of stag's horn or potions of powdered gold. Desperate times called for desperate measures.
Take a live frog and lay the belly of it next to the plague sore. If the patient will escape the plague, the frog will burst.
Having escaped the plague, the Pope sought to prevent its spread elsewhere. He ordered devout processions and encouraged ceremonies that involved a new sect, the flagellants.
Miserere nobis, Domine. Miserere nobis, Domine.
They practiced self-flagellation in an attempt to purge mankind of sin. Flagellants roamed the countryside, believing that their self-imposed pain and suffering would cause God to lift his curse and save the world. Before long, the flagellants openly criticized the Catholic Church for failing the people at this crucial time. They interrupted religious services and looted church property. In their search for scapegoats, they falsely accused the Jews of poisoning the drinking water. Throughout Europe, Jews were massacred. The Pope realized that the movement he himself had encouraged was now a grave threat to public order. He sent letters to the kings of Europe, ordering them to suppress the flagellants. The movement disappeared, but their dissent added to a growing feeling that perhaps the established church was no longer absolute. The plague would stay in any one place for several months and then move on. In just 2 years, it had swept across Western Europe, spread north over to England, and then finally to Scandinavia. By 1350, it had run its course. The Black Death killed a third of Europe's population. Over 20 million people died. This devastation was a turning point that changed the face of Europe beyond recognition. Michael of Piazza recorded the chaos that the plague had left in its wake. Families were torn apart, villages deserted, business collapsed, states bankrupted by loss of taxes. Those who survived bore the burden of guilt. A new mentality emerged. There was a strengthened belief in God, but an increased skepticism about the established church. Shortage of labor had shifted the balance of power between the lords and their tenants. Authority and tradition were no longer accepted without question. The cause of the plague would remain a mystery until the late 19th century. It was then discovered that the rats and fleas were the carriers of the bacillus, but that it was the fleas that transmitted the disease from the rats to man. A single flea bite can cause death. After the Black Death, the plague returned to haunt Europe every few decades until the mid-17th century, though never again with the ferocity of that first outbreak.
Of the great civilizations of East Asia, Japan's was the latest to develop. In origin, it was derived from and was largely an adaptation of cultures from the mainland, especially from China. However, the fact that the Japanese lagged many centuries behind China and India and made their most rapid progress under the stimulus of borrowings from China does not prove that the island dwellers were lacking in ability or originality. For many centuries, the Japanese maintained contact with and continued to receive cultural impetus from Korea, which means that they were being influenced indirectly by the older and richer civilization of China. of the Han and later dynasties. The Japanese had invaded southern Korea in 369 AD and intervened in Korean politics to maintain a balance of power, siding with one and then another of the three kingdoms into which Korea was divided during this time. Of fundamental importance for the later history of Japan was the introduction, by way of Korea, of the Chinese system of writing. The Japanese was mainly made up of clans, the strongest clan being the Yamamoto clan, and they were so impressed with the Tang capital in China that they finally had built their own capital city in Kyoto around 800 AD. And from there, they started to develop the feudal system, and the clans would war each other until one of them would finally become shogun.
The samurai and the warlords they served answered not to the emperor, but to the shogun. It was his will that ruled supreme. The shogun was the man of cunning who could rise to the pinnacle of power in Japan, who could finally, through war, bring peace to that warlike nation. He was more politician than the emperor, more general than the warlords he dominated. He was the shogun, supreme tactician of Japan. In a land of intrigue, he who could achieve the right balance between waging war and pursuing peace was the shogun. At the center of virtually every chapter of Japanese medieval history, there was war and conflict. And at the center of the conflict was the daimyo, the local warlord. It was he who chose the fights, and he who led armies of men who drenched Japan in centuries of blood. Japan was ruled by an emperor. The warlords served the royal court. That is, until one day in the year 1192, when the nation paused and set off in a new direction. That was the day a warlord, Minamoto Yoritomo, declared himself shogun. While all Japan bowed their heads to the emperor, it was the shogun whose will ruled.
A shogun was a military dictator of Japan. The word is actually a shortened version of the full title, Seiita Shogun, which literally means commander-in-chief for the suppression of barbarians, the barbarians being the enemies of the shogun.
In the Middle Ages, Japan was a group of islands with no central government. Instead, hundreds of local warlords carved their own small territories out of these misty hills and valleys. Warlords and their samurai fought among themselves year after year, decade after decade, for control of the scarce farmland. Eventually, two power blocks developed, the Taira in the west and the Minamoto in the east.
Soon, as the years went by, these two families would come into conflict with each other and threaten the very existence of the imperial system they were rewarded for supporting.
During this war, we are going to see Japan's top warrior, known as the samurai, and we will get back to the shogun later.
Japan's two greatest clans fought a war of annihilation. The leader of the Taira clan gathered his soldiers to hunt down his bitter rival, the Minamoto. Few of the Minamoto survived. not even their chief. His young sons, Yoritomo and Yoshitsune, escaped. They swore to take up the sword and avenge their father. They would follow the path of honor or death, the way of the samurai.
There is a way of bringing up the child of a samurai. From the time of infancy, one should encourage bravery. If a person is affected by cowardice as a child, it remains a lifetime scar.
The boys Yoritomo and Yoshitsune were born into a samurai family and a way of life ruled by honor. For the boys, the shame of living under the same sky as the man who killed their father was too much to bear. They were bound to seek vengeance. They would follow Bushido, the way of the warrior. The samurai were a class apart, professional warriors born to fight. The very word means to serve. A samurai placed himself in the care of a lord. In return, the warrior pledged to his master his life. Obeying orders without pause, he would know no other life than to train and fight for the leader of his clan. Only 6% of the Japanese were samurai, and they intermarried to maintain their privileged stock. Over the centuries, from bands of landowning warriors scattered across Japan, the clans of samurai evolved. Yoritomo and Yoshitsune were born into the powerful clan of the Minamoto. By the 12th century, many clans had become great armies and mortal rivals. Japan was at ceaseless war with itself. Destined to lead the Minamoto, the brothers were now separated for their safety and sent away to finish their training for war. Samurai were trained in the arts of Sojutsu and Naginata, the long spear and the halberd. The ultimate skill of the samurai was kenjutsu, the art of swordsmanship. The samurai valued his sword above all else, so much that in time it became the symbol of his soul. It was made to kill a man with one blow. Then, with a flick of the wrist, the warrior would shake off the blood of his enemy. The young samurai would learn where a man was weakest. A cut to the side of the throat would sever the jugular and kill within 3 or 4 seconds. A slash to the wrists, kidneys, or armpit a little longer. For nearly 2 decades, Yoshitsune had trained for the chance to avenge his father. Now, once again, the Taira and the Minamoto would clash. Both sides followed the strict rituals of samurai warfare.
The riders charged by turns and vied to announce their names. Their shouts and yells awoke echoes in the mountains. I am Kajiwara Heizo, a Minamoto warrior worth 1,000 men. If anyone here considers himself my equal,
Let him kill me and display my head to his chief.
After a day of bloody fighting, the Taira retreated to their boats. Fastening a fan to a mast, they taunted the Minamoto to strike it with a single arrow. Yoshitsune summoned a young warrior famed for his archery. The honor of the clan was in the young samurai's hands. He rowed out into the rough sea and closed his eyes in silent prayer.
Hail, great Bodhisattva Hachiman, and the gods of my province. Vouchsafe that I may hit the center of that fan. If I miss, I will smash my bow and kill myself.
In answer to his prayers, the sea grew calm. All watched in silence. He notched his arrow and steadied his breathing. Then he took aim and fired.
The arrow flew straight to the fan, thudded into it, and cut it loose. For a time, the fan fluttered in the air. Then it fell abruptly towards the sea.
As it floated on the waves, the skill of the samurai was honored by loud cheers from both armies. For 5 years, the fighting between the clans wore on. Yoshitsune reached a Taira stronghold and a turning point. At Ichinotani, he launched his most daring assault. Dominating the shoreline, backed by a treacherous cliff, the fortress was thought invincible. With a handful of trusted men, Yoshitsune rode up to the outcrop overlooking the castle. From his vantage, Yoshitsune decided to test the precipitous route by sending riderless horses down the cliff.
Some of the horses broke their legs and fell. Others descended in safety. Three of them reached the roof and stood there, trembling.
Where horses alone could go, Yoshitsune decided, so could riders. Now the renowned horsemanship of his men would be put to the test.
He galloped forward at the head of 30 horsemen, and all the others followed, descending a slope so steep that the rear rider's stirrups touched the front rider's helmets. The tense riders went down with their eyes closed, encouraging their horses in muffled voices.
Yoshitsune signaled his warriors down by the shore, the wealthy mounted on horseback, the others on foot. They launched their attack. From the rear, Yoshitsune and 30 riders stormed into the castle. The Taira warriors turned to face the real danger. Too late.
They raised a great battle cry, and great numbers of panic-stricken Taira warriors galloped into the sea to save themselves.
A Minamoto warrior by the name of Nozone gave chase.
He saw a lone rider splash into the sea. Nazane rode up alongside him, gripped with all his strength, crashed with him to the ground. He pushed aside his helmet to cut off his head. He was 16 years old, a boy, just the age of Nazane's own son.
Tucked into his belt was a flute. This was the boy who just hours before had played so sweetly.
I would spare you, he said, holding back his tears. But there are Minamoto warriors everywhere. You cannot escape. It is better if I kill you than another, for I will offer prayers for you.
Tears pouring from his eyes, Nazone steeled himself and sliced off the boy's head with one clean blow. After battle, each samurai gathered his trophies, the heads of the vanquished. Their faces were washed, their hair combed, and the heads laid out with labels naming both slain and slayer, so the lord of the clan could inspect them. Those who brought back the heads of renowned enemies were lavished with titles and estates for their valor. Months after the victory at Ichinotani, the Taira clan was finally crushed. 24 years after their father's murder, the brothers had their revenge. Yoritomo, the leader of the victorious Minamoto, was raised to shogun, supreme military ruler of Japan. For his brother, Yoshitsune, the joy of victory was cut short. His bravery in battle had made him popular and made the shogun jealous. Yoritomo issued his own brother's death warrant. Since boyhood, every warrior was prepared for the final self-sacrifice, a ritual permitted to no one but a samurai, seppuku. Through it, a warrior could atone for an act of disgrace. Yoshitsune sought only to preserve his honor. Better to die by one's own sword than be hunted down like an animal.
There is but one resolute path for the warrior to take. It is that of death.
Yoshitsune's page brought him a last drink of sake. Then he presented him with a short sword, its blade wrapped in silk to soak up his blood.
For a moment, he seemed to collect his thoughts for the last time. And then, stabbing himself deeply below the waist on the left side, he drew the dirk slowly across to the right side, and turning it in the wound, gave a slight cut upwards. He never moved a muscle on his face. He uttered no sound.